Good afternoon. We're in the Gospel of John, and we've been looking at the suffering of Christ and his death last week, and we should always approach passages like these. And the passage before us today, just five verses, they are somber passages, they are grave passages. And just as we go to a funeral service, so is the mood here as we come to God's word. His body's removed, buried today. In the passage, John chapter 19, and let's just read from verse 38 to 42. John chapter 19, verse 38 to 42. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier came to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus, bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Tomb. Last time, which was 2 weeks ago, in this gospel, we observed the crucifixion and the death of Jesus and his triumphant cry. And we see that cry was not, "It's over," but "It's finished, it's accomplished, it is finished," as Jesus breathed his last and committed his soul to God. And we noted he did that in full assurance, according to the scriptures, that promised that his body will not see decay. And God will raise him in 3 days from the dead, even as Jesus himself taught. Now the last five verses of John 19 before us count for us the removal of Christ's now lifeless body from the cross and his burial in a nearby tomb. We learn from the Gospel of Matthew what's also happened, which John doesn't record for us, is for fear of conspiracy, by his disciples, the chief priests, seeing this funeral procession, if you like, request Pilate that he make the tomb secure. And this was based, of course, on the claim of the chief priests that an impostor had said after 3 days that Jesus will rise from the dead. But that was, of course, Jesus' own teaching himself. And Pilate complies. He has the tomb sealed and a guard posted outside. Now, none of the four Gospels records for us anything regarding Christ between his death and his resurrection, except they make this abundantly clear: he was truly dead. The Son of Man's body was dead. But nothing's recorded regarding Christ's spirit from the time that it left his body, not here in the Gospels. In fact, Mark records for us when the chief priests go to Pilate, he's surprised because it's early that Jesus was dead, confirming to us the Roman practice of prolonged suffering for vicious criminals who got this death on the cross. Death by crucifixion was reserved for the most notorious, the most wicked, and the suffering was intended by the Romans to be protracted and as degrading as possible. And Pilate calls the centurion and to confirm, "Is Jesus already dead?" This normally goes on for hours, and the body's normally left out there for days, but he is assured it is so. So when we come to our text today, it's a simple text, and yet it's an important text, this burial of Jesus. And I have two main points. And the first point is two secret disciples. And I'm calling them that because that's what they appear to be in the scriptures, the two secret disciples. Consider the scene at the foot of the cross after Jesus had died, given up his spirit. He'd been pierced with a Roman spear. And curious onlookers, you can be sure how any of this kind of spectacle attracts the crowds. Any walking by had been wait for the other two thieves now to die on each side, whose legs had been broken, the weight of their bodies making it impossible for them to breathe. And the thieves probably had nobody there, because any friends who'd be there would be marked as accomplices. But for Christ, who was there as he lay hung there dead on the cross? Those who hate him, they were there to be sure of his death. And those curious for a spectacle, given the fame of Christ in around Jerusalem and Galilee, mainly on account of his miracles. As for family and friends and disciples, they only seemed to be a handful, most likely for fear of the Jews, as was proved in the case of Peter in his denial. In fact, the scriptures tell us that the disciples, the other 10 at least that fled, it seems only John was there, Jesus, and Mary, Jesus' mother, and Mary and his sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, Mary's sister, that is, and Mary Magdalene, the three Marys. And the faith of these women stands out, not only during their ministry, how they took care of Jesus, but now, in his darkest hour, these women loved Christ, and they were there. And it's Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, too, who follow the burial party. They want to see where he's to be buried, because they already intend to come back on the first day of the week with fresh spices, etc. As Christ taught, those who'd been forgiven much loved much. They would not be deterred from being there, despite the Romans and the Jews. And of course, the disciple whom Jesus loved was there. And yet we find today a most unlikely pair. And those we would have considered having the smallest faith exhibit strong faith and bravery at this time. Two secret disciples are there. We have three brief subpoints. The rich stranger is the first. The rich stranger, verse 38, after these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took away his body. And so Joseph of Arimathea is the first secret disciple. We don't know much about him. In fact, besides all four accounts of the gospel mentioning him in this regard, nothing else is said of him. Well, almost nothing else. Remarkably, in the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 9, and they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death. Though they had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. And Joseph, presumably a rich man, and his new tomb in which no one had been buried. And he wishes to make this available for Christ. And that prompted him, as the scriptures tell us, to take courage. He was a disciple, but he was a fearful disciple. He was a secret disciple. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was on the Jewish council. And he had to take courage to ask Pilate for the body of Jesus. Mark's account in chapter 15 says, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council who was also looking for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. A respected member of the council, the Sanhedrin. Luke's account in 23 gives us a little more detail. Now there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council, a good and righteous man who had not consented to their decision and action, and he was looking for the kingdom of God. Joseph didn't have the benefit as a disciple as the 11 had, who lived closely with Christ. Though he believed in Christ, He was afraid. He had to take courage. In the scriptures tell us, expose himself as a follower, and for an important man, possibly jeopardize his position in the church. He was surrounded every day, not by Jesus and Jesus' teaching, but he was surrounded by hostile, Christ-hating high priests and council members who resorted to lies and deceit and bribery and false witnesses to put Christ to death. However, he did not consent when the vote was called. The one whom he believed in, no doubt having searched the scriptures himself, the Messiah, had been shamefully treated and now killed unjustly, and Joseph can no longer be silent. Small, weak, starting faith grows to public profession. He is no longer afraid and will no longer hide his faith. This brings us to the second secret disciple, another Jewish council member. Number two, another Jewish council member. Perhaps they were friends. Nicodemus also, who had earlier come to Jesus at night. This man, unlike the little-known Joseph, needs no introduction, thanks to John chapter 3, isn't it? John chapter 3, which the whole world knows about. Nicodemus, also a member of the Sanhedrin, is mentioned one other time, you may recall, when he stood up for Jesus. He clearly also was afraid and didn't say much, and he was there when they voted to put Christ to death. And he stands up for Christ in John 7. You may recall in our study, Nicodemus, who had gone to him before and who was one of them, said, "Does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what this does?" And this earned him the ridicule of the other councilmen. "What? Are you also a Galilean?" they said to him, the two secret disciples. He too, it was, who came to Jesus under the cover of darkness, was afraid of the other council members. And after meeting Jesus, who brings the gospel to him in a magnificent way, isn't it? One that's remembered throughout history. And John chapter 3, verse 16, and faith in Christ and the work of the Spirit. What a marvelous passage. He goes away, and not much more is said about him until now. And Nicodemus comes openly and publicly to assist Joseph with the burial. Presumably a man of means too, probably with a string of servants also, carrying 75 pounds of the sweet-smelling spices, not the regular aloe and myrrh, but imported, an abundant amount to provide for, in the third place, a fitting burial. A fitting burial, for this is what it was here. Nicodemus also, verse 39, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing him a mixture of myrrh, aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. They took the body of Jesus, bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was the garden, and in the garden was a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Though with the wicked in his death, brothers and sisters, on a cursed cross, Jesus is treated here by these two secret disciples, exhibiting great faith. Formerly weak in faith, secret disciples. Jesus is buried by them and carefully laid in the tomb. In that new tomb, fit for a king. And one commentator suggests there was enough of these spices to bury 200 men. There they lay the Savior's body, truly man, truly God. And Jesus was truly dead. Jesus died and was buried. And there's a lesson here, a quick lesson on the side, and you ought to really be teaching yourself the lessons as we go through the scriptures, but the lesson here is given for the proper respect and burial to be shown to the dead, as was the custom according to the Jews and the Holy Scriptures. Man was created in God's image. And it was God who breathed life into man, everyone in the image of God. And that life is precious. No matter how much it's been marred and broken and distorted, that image, it is God himself who buried Moses. And no one knows to this day where he was buried. God laid Moses' body to rest and buried him. And here, a prophet like Moses, but a greater one, is respected in his burial. Well, this is in the text for us. But in the second place, our second and final main point, we have triumph in death and burial. Triumph in death and burial. As mentioned, although the Gospels are largely silent between the time of Christ's death and his resurrection, the Scriptures do shed some light on where the Spirit of Christ was when it left his body. Despite the multiple assurances of Christ to his disciples, as well as the Old Testament testimony of the Old Testament Scriptures, which speaks to the resurrection of Christ from the dead, now to all the disciples of Christ, those at the foot of the cross, and those not present or in fear and in hiding, one thing is abundantly clear here this day, that Jesus had died. This was the reality. And if you've ever lost a loved one, even a loved one in Christ, whether you view the body or simply hear of the death, this is a shocking reality before you. This person is dead. His soul has left his body. And on this earth, and possibly for eternity, you will never see this person again. Brothers and sisters, death is a part of life. It is one of the great certainties of life. And I don't know what tomorrow brings to you, whether wealth or fame, your education, how many children, young people, you will have. But this one thing we know, you will die. For it is appointed for a man to die once, and then comes judgment. All those at the foot of the cross that day, and those who happened to pass along the way, to or from Jerusalem, possibly hundreds of people would have seen Christ's lifeless body hanging on the cross. And Joseph and Nicodemus appear, most likely assisted by their servants, possibly the Roman soldiers. They remove Christ's lifeless body from the cross. His bleeding wounds no longer flowed with blood, and his lifeless body lay limp in their arms, possibly just a handful of true disciples. Among them, the three Marys and John, they would have stood weeping there as Jesus' body was wrapped. This spectacle before them, the reality of death, their Lord, Master, and Teacher. There seems to be little consolation now, as when you lose a loved one, he has died. The chief priests and Jews would almost certainly have stood by as his body was removed. In fact, we are told as they see him going to the tomb, they run off to Pilate to have this sealed. Brothers and sisters, what at the time seemed the end, even to the disciples, must have seemed like defeat in their small faith. How could things have played out this way? Yes, even though Christ had said it, it cannot be right. But we know, brothers and sisters and friends here today, there was great triumph in death that day. It was a glorious day in the spiritual realms. Things unseen by human eyes, the eyes of faith, or even the closest disciples were unable to comprehend these things for the literal darkness that had shadowed the cross at this time, had clouded their minds, it seemed. It is finished. Christ's work and pardon and reconciliation had been accomplished. This was a day of great triumph. He bore our sin. He bore God's judgment in his body on that tree, and it was over. And where was the Spirit of Christ? In hell? Suffering? No. The scriptures teach us that he was in victory. It is like he was clothed in the armor of God as a triumphant warrior, having conquered sin and death and hell, parading in triumph in the deepest parts of the earth, and from Sheol, there where the blessed departed saints of God had been waiting for this event, there they are released as Christ leads the captives, these captive souls, to the throne of God. That's where Christ's Spirit was. That's what was going on behind the scenes. There was great triumph in the death of Christ, despite that lifeless body of Christ in the arms of Joseph and Nicodemus, now laid in the tomb, and the weeping of all the saints. Read in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. You needn't turn there. And it's quoting Psalm 68, verse 18. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. And Paul, by his Spirit, explains what took place here, and that Christ had to descend. In verse 9 it says, in saying he ascended, what does it mean? But he had to descend into the lowest regions of the earth. He who descended is the one also who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Consider Psalm 49 also, verse 14 and 15. Listen to this. Like sheep when they are appointed for Sheol, death shall be their shepherd. The upright shall rule over them in the morning. Their form shall be consumed in Sheol with no place to dwell. But God will ransom my soul from the power of Sheol, for he will receive me. Brothers and sisters, it is remarkable what Christ accomplished by his death on the cross. I quote, Christ performed the condemnation of sin on the earth, the abolition of curse upon the cross, the redemption of corruption in the grave, the dissolution of death in hell, going to every place that he might everywhere work man's salvation. That is what Christ accomplished in his death and in his burial and his resurrection. Christ, in his omniscience, his omnipresence, and his omnipotent spirit, no longer restricted by his voluntary manhood in his body, has by his perfect life, his substitutionary death and burial, accomplished all things. And his grave is a great victory, for at death these things were done. It is finished. And his church's salvation is truly finished and accomplished. And though it's Friday, Sunday's coming. Sunday's coming. When Christ will be raised from the dead, and in that resurrection body, he ascended to his Father, just as every believer will be raised with him in their resurrection bodies, bypassing Sheol and hell, because he conquered sin and death and hell for the child of God. Brothers and sisters, that is what was going on behind the scenes. That is what Christ accomplished on the cross for you and for me. Death was not the end. And we as believers die with Christ. We are buried with Christ, and we will be raised with Christ incorruptible one day. That is what the scriptures teach us. To close off this afternoon, I have three, and I'm sure you have many more applications. One being, of course, do not ever be ashamed of Christ. Jesus' own words, those who are ashamed of me before men, of him I will be ashamed. And the true believer, with his small faith and his fear in these two men comes out and ends as strong faith, in a public profession of faith. Never, never, ever be ashamed of your Lord and Savior. But those aren't my 3 points of application. Number one, do not look down on small faith. Do not look down on small faith. Consider Nicodemus and Joseph. Faith starts small, and growth in grace and faith increases and matures with our progressive sanctification. And Pastor Sam preached on this recently. A babe in Christ needs the pure spiritual milk of the word. Increased faith comes with time and our attention to the public means of grace. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Every one of Christ's disciples, the very best of them, who achieved great things, even the Apostle Paul that we think about, facing danger, persecution, and death, were initially spoken of by Christ as what? Oh, ye of little faith. And one of his closest three denies him three times. But he's the preacher on the day of Pentecost. The young in Christ, the new disciple, with the smallest of faith and understanding of salvation and of the doctrine of God. But he has come to Christ in faith. That one is precious to Christ. And Christ died for him. They are to be received and loved and nurtured in the church as those chosen and precious by God. Do not despise the day of small things. Help the weak in faith. Pastor Sam preached on this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 14. And we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle. Encourage the faint-hearted. Help the weak. Be patient with them all. The path of the righteous is progressive and sometimes slow as the Spirit of God transforms us into the image of his dear Son. Despite our weakness in faith, despite our remaining sin, until that day when we will be made perfect at his coming. Proverbs 4:18, I love this verse. But the path of the righteous is like the first light of day. Some versions say the first gleam of dawn. That tiny, small faith, I believe, which shines brighter and brighter until the full light of day. Do not despise small faith. Brothers and sisters, those of us who have been believers for 30 and 40 years, we still exhibit in many things small faith. Secondly, our second application, some of the very worst and weakest of men, some of the most lofty and lowly, the upright and the wicked, of all of these are chosen by God to be drawn to his Son. Brothers and sisters, God has chosen his people from every language and tribe and nation, including the Jews, as a people for his own possession. The gospel is universal. It is no respect of persons, knows no boundaries, sets no social limits. We see a man come to the church and we're like, he can't be a Christian. What is he even doing here? How we see this beautifully displayed there at the foot of the cross. A righteous woman, a normal woman and her sister, a prostitute, a thief, two members of the Sanhedrin, rich men, poor men, a fisherman, the least and the greatest of sinners, drawn to God by Christ. Brothers and sisters, never lose a strong desire to see all classes of men come to Christ. And we ought to be the aroma of Christ to them, to all men, even those that are perishing. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 12, for we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. The gospel is a gospel all of grace, a gospel which is all God's undeserved mercy. Do not think that you were chosen by God because of your righteousness. There is nothing in any man that would draw God to him. Yet God saves men and women from every race and language and social class. God will save whom he will, for God so loved the world. Thirdly and finally, and here is a wonderful lesson, encouragement for those of us, that's all of us, who will die one day, every one of us. Believer, you need not fear death for yourself or your loved ones in the Lord. Believer, you need not fear death. As we consider all that Christ has accomplished in his perfect life, in his suffering, in his death, in his burial for 3 days, in his resurrection and ascension, here's the great takeaway. Believer, you need not fear death. Our very own Dr. Samuel Renan wrote a book on the Descent. You may be familiar with it. And he writes, and I quote, and it's a long quote, but I had to read this. Therefore, do not be afraid to die, Christian. The good shepherd is now the shepherd of death, and you shall never see Sheol. The dead who die in the Lord are with the Lord. They are at rest, blessed, in the house of the Lord, in the temple not made with human hands, the habitation of God's presence, paradise, the heaven of heavens, the holy places that Jesus opened for us by the blood of his covenant. Death has been swallowed up in death. Believer, we need not fear death, for we will be changed, incorruptible. 1 Corinthians 15, for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That is what Christ accomplished on the cross. And when Christ gave up his spirit, that was the victory march to every place of the omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. Christ's spirit moved throughout the deepest parts of the earth and released those souls to the throne of God. The death, burial, descent, resurrection, ascension, and session of Christ should fortify the faith of every saint. It is because he lived the sinless life. It is because he took my place and died in my place, and he took the punishment of my sin, and because he was dead and buried and raised again, as we'll see next Lord's Day, because of that, I will be raised imperishable. As that well-known chorus goes, we sing this a lot when I was young, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, yes, I know, he holds the future, and life is worth the living, just because he lives. And death has no sting. The believer need not fear death. Oh, brothers and sisters, let us long for and pray for the salvation of our friends and family, the unwanted, of the murderer and the thief and the rapist. For Christ died to save the sins of his people, and they are everywhere. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, how we thank you for the gospel of salvation. Lord Jesus Christ, teach us what it meant to be lifted high. Teach us what it meant for the Holy One to bear away my sin. Oh, Father, help us in the light of all that you accomplished, in the light of that sure and certain resurrection to perfection and immortality, help us to live lives of holiness, pleasing you. Help us to be the aroma of life to those who believe and to those who are perishing. Rescue the perishing, we pray. We pray for our families. We pray for any here today who have not looked upon Christ and believed in him. Oh Lord, hear our prayer as we come to this table to remind ourselves, as you told us, of your suffering and your death, and to proclaim that death until he comes. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen.